You're watching PEGRI TV, Rhode Island's public access channel.
I don't
want to
grow up,
but... I'm here to show the world, I'm here to show the world.
Welcome, everybody, to Figures R Us, your official collector's show, got it right this time, and Q&A show of the official Russ Museum. I am your host, Angel.
And I am back, blazing icon Aunt Missy.
She's filling in for Pebbles this week. He's out on vacation, lucky guy, doing his thing. So today we're going to be talking about some great things.
Yes.
If you guys missed it, make sure you guys check out Off the Ropes. It's about the Hardy Boys this week.
Yeah.
They are unbelievable. By none, the whole show is dedicated to them. And the following show that we're going to be doing is The American Dream, Dusty Rhodes.
Yeah, can't wait for that one,
so we can't wait. You know, hats off to that. If you guys have not done it yet, I don't know why. It's very simple. If you don't have a dumb, use a pen, it'll work too. Take our Smile Up Challenge. Smile your dumb up, spread more smiles than hate in the world. Guys like Jeff Hardy, John Cena's taking it, Lana's taking it, Braun Strowman, if he can take it, anybody can take it.
Right. And he's got some hands.
Yeah, he does. And also, you know, speaking about getting some hands, his tag team partner, his former tag team champion partner, Nicholas, is actually doing a meet and greet at his father's donut shop.
Yep.
It's a free meet and greet. All the information you can get on our website at theofficialwrestlingmuseum.com.
Check it out, guys.
Yep. Check out the autograph page, and it's going to be listed. It's 4 hours. He's going to be there signing autographs. Good thing is it's free, so there's no child labor laws, and it's going to be a great time.
Hey, why not?
Today we are talking about one of the most popular series, I think, ever for professional wrestling figures.
You could probably say it's like the mother of all figure series, okay?
Well, it is. It's because it's, and I think the reason why we're saying that is because this is the longest produced series of all times.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and nothing's come close. There have been close ones with the classic superstars, the basics, but nothing has ran this long.
Right.
So why don't you kick? I'll give you the honors of kicking it off.
All right. So they were first produced in 1994, guys. That's a long time ago. But it was shortly after Hasbro's action figures for WWF line was seized.
Mm-hmm.
It was obviously the longest running figure line ever, and it lasted until 2001.
Now think about it. Now that's big, because these figures are only about 4 or 5 inches, these Bendems.
Yeah.
Okay. And for them to be able to produce that much and literally only get released every couple of months, I think, was phenomenal.
Right.
And it was the, oh my God, we need to have them type of things.
And anybody and everybody wanted them, because in all honesty, like, they are probably one of the hardest things to break. They're so well made that they just last forever, and I think that's probably why they made it run so long.
And it's funny that you said that, because I have never seen one Bendem that had a missing hand, that had a missing foot, nothing. WCW came out with a set, and their figures would break. The old school WWE ones, or WWF with the LJN guys, their hands are always missing. These are so well made.
Yep.
And each package even came with a special trading card, that it was just more of a collectible item.
Right.
And I think that's why people want these series so much.
Definitely.
I remember when Series 1 first came out.
Right.
And it was like, oh my God, I have to go get them.
Right.
You know, I just had to.
Right. The color scheme of their packaging changed for each series that they did, which was good, because it's not all the same boring package, especially for those people that like to collect them, just not for, you know, like myself, I buy them for my son. He plays with them in the series now. Like we have, I think, an Uso with a missing arm, and we have, you know, all, like, I think Sasha might have a missing foot or something. Like,
yeah,
it just,
I think so.
It's just he finds a way to just break them. And like our daughter, she collects them. So when she collects them, it's nice to see the different boxes. She's a huge Bayley fan. So she's got, you know, her NXT that's in the actual, like, square box. Then she's got, you know, the other, you know, first time in the line figure that's just the plastic with the cardboard on the back. Like, it just, you know, the fact that they used to change the color schemes before for these ones is good, because they're starting to get that way with these series that they're putting out now. It's definitely, you know, something that is eye-catching. It draws your attention to it, especially for the old school figures, because,
yes,
you know, the older generation people might be like, oh, hey, you know, do I have that one? Oh, it's got a green background. Oh, I don't have that one because I have one that's blue, or I have one that's red, or they know that they
right.
have who they have because they have the color background.
Right. You know, when they decided to come up with something like that, that's something different too, because
right.
the LJN had the different color boxes,
right.
you know, towards the end, and we touched upon that last week. Hasbro figures, they started to come up with the different series that fans liked it. I
right.
think the reason they stuck with this is it was easy for them to keep it going, and plus the figures were never listed as 1, 2, 3. They used numerals.
Yeah.
So you had the two lines for two, you had
yep.
a V, you had an X. And that wasn't really being taught that well in school. They were starting to do away with it. So I think it was a great thing. Series
Definitely.
One started out. It had Bret the Hitman Hart,
wow.
Doink the Clown, Razor Ramon, Diesel, and Lex Luger. Right here we have Bret Hart and Lex Luger. Now I remember when Lex Luger came out, these came out roughly at the same time WWE Hasbro's was super released.
Mm-hmm.
And the Lex Luger Hasbro figure was very, very hard to find.
Right.
And a lot of people were getting tricked by calling, like, Toys R Us
yep.
that just went out of business.
Right.
And they were saying, yeah, we got the Lex Luger, we got the Lex Luger. You come down, it was a bendable.
Yeah.
And people were still buying them. Well,
right.
now the Lex Luger bendable is rare.
Yeah.
Because people were getting them and they're like, oh, whatever. You know, and they were playing with them. It's hard to find them, you know, closed and
right.
still in the package.
Right.
Series 2, they had the 1-2-3 Kid, Ultimate War, I'm sorry, The Undertaker, Mabel, and the British Bulldog. Again, the color change is a little fading, you
right.
know, and the difference in the boxes. But they had the British Bulldog there.
Right.
The Mabel in this series, and even the 1-2-3 Kid, was phenomenal. How it looked, how it was brought to life and everything, in my opinion.
Nice. Series 3, they had Ahmed Johnson, Goldust, Shawn Michaels, and Yokozuna.
Yep. Now, I don't know what they were trying to do, if they were trying to mock as Sheamus, you know,
I don't know.
20 years
he
in the time and knew he was
white,
coming.
Though.
But he was very white, and people never understood that. I remember reading a report stating that they think the reason for it is because they had to use more rubber in the figure, so they couldn't keep the dye color going through.
Right.
I don't know how true that is, but that's what I remember reading, you know, a few years back when
right.
I was looking into the series and stuff, because it was something I was really into, these bendables.
Yeah.
Or bendums.
What about Series 4? Mark Marrow, that guy, he's phenomenal right now.
Right.
So I'm sure that's going to be something that's going to come up to be, you know,
right.
something that's going to be rare.
And that's something that we even have signed in the museum. It's his Bendable figure.
Yes, yep.
And we have the Sunny one
yep.
signed in the museum.
Yep. Too bad, you know, rest in peace, Vader. Too bad he passed too soon
right.
to, you know, get this signed as a part of the artifact in the museum. But, you know, you got Vader. That looks phenomenal.
Right.
Psycho Sid was also one that was part
right.
of that series. And in Series 5, they had Farouk, Rocky Maivia, Mankind, Maivia, sorry,
yep.
Mankind, and Steve Austin.
Right. Now, what's cool about this is when they decided to come out with Series, just double checking, Series 9, the red boxes,
mm-hmm.
they said, you know what, we want to come up with a new Rock figure.
Right.
And instead of them releasing it as a rock, they put them in Series 5.
Yeah.
The packaging in the back, the name of the pitches are there, but they literally came out years apart from each other.
Wow.
Literally like 2.5, 3 years apart.
That's crazy.
That they came out apart from each other. Actually, I think it was, you know, a little more than that.
Mm-hmm.
But you had the Rocky Maivia and you had the Rock.
Right. Series 6, they have Hunter Hearst Helmsley. I am so sorry, guys, if I pronounced names wrong.
Yeah, the Game, Triple H, before he was the Game.
Undertaker 2, it says.
Yep, this is the second one they released of the Undertaker.
Oh, okay,
yep,
now I get it.
That was the second one, yep.
Then they have Hawk and Animal.
Yep.
Which these guys, two of another tag team. We were talking about tag teams with Jeff and Matt, and these guys are another tag team that was really, really good.
Right, and I always loved the way these actually looked in the packages.
Yeah, they are
how
cool.
They, you know what I mean? They really did the detail. They really did what they needed to do with the packages to make sure they got them out right.
Right.
You have your next series, the Series 7,
right.
With Crush, Ken Shamrock,
yep.
The late, great Owen Hart, and then we also had, I'm just skipping on, the Patriot. Which the Patriots did sign one for our museum too.
I remember meeting him. He was really cool.
Right?
He was excited to see that. He hasn't seen something like that in a while.
Right, I remember that.
Yep.
Yeah. And these packages too, they're only like 5-6 inches.
Yeah.
You know, you can literally take up a whole small portion on your wall for the whole entire set. That's what's so cool about these figures.
And they're very well put together box-wise.
Yeah.
A lot of the boxes you'll notice like, they, you know, pop apart with the plastic to the cardboard. These ones, they seem like, even though they were like start of their beginning lines, they seem like they really took the time to make sure that if you were gonna collect something, that you were gonna collect it and it was gonna stay together for you to collect and it was not gonna, you know, be something cheap that you were spending your money on.
Right, the only things that I ever found with this was always the edges. We'll get kind of shuffled up a little bit.
That's the only part. Cardboard, so you kind of expect
that. And sometimes the cutout in the back would.
Right.
You know, but here's Series 8, and you have China right here.
Right.
Taka Michinoku.
Taka Michinoku, Kane, and Jeff Jarrett.
Yep. And I personally like the Jarrett figure in this series. I know we have China here, and I like the China. But Jarrett was just, it's that old school look of Jeff Jarrett. It's phenomenal. It's great. It's a great collector piece to have. If you're going to be a collector, that's the one you want to grab.
Right, definitely. What about Series 9 about Brian Christopher, Cactus Jack, Sable, and X-Pac?
Yep, here's Sable right here. And then again, this is the series, though, that they came out with this Rock figure.
Right.
That was not a part of this series. It was something totally different time frame. But again, this is a really great series. The Cactus Jack one in here is great. It's phenomenal. I know we just said it, and I don't, we didn't have it with us, but here is the Jeff Jarrett.
Oh, sweet.
You know what I mean? It's the old school classic look.
Yeah.
You know, it's just the money-making look right there.
Yep.
You know, from him as well, too. So I'm glad I found that in the box.
Right. Series 10. Has Edge, Road Dogg, Billy Gunn, and Steve Blackman.
Yep. And when this series came out, they were very surprised of people like Steve Blackman making it in. Steve Blackman was making a huge name in professional wrestling.
Oh, yeah. Now,
you know what I mean? But when he got made, people were like, oh, my God. And you had the New Age Outlaws that was very over in Edge. It just made the series a really big popular one. And when they came out with this is the first time they released between this series and the series prior to it.
Right.
Two series at one time. They never did something like this. So this is something new they were introducing, and it works still in their favor.
Yeah, definitely. What series do we have
now? We're on 11.
All right. We have Al Snow, The Godfather, Val Venus, and Vince McMahon.
Yep. You know, if McMahon can get a figure, it's got to be a great series because he's not going to put his image to anything.
No, he won't just put his name to anything.
We don't have the Al Snow here. It is signed for the museum, though.
Yes.
You can go to the official wrestlingmuseum.com and see it on the site, excuse me. But this one actually has the head.
I was going to say, didn't they put a little head?
Yep, it does. And it's just so well, like, detailed, the mannequin head. Like, I'm like, wow, really?
For Al Snow, it's very, very well detailed because he was very crazy when he did things back in the day.
He's definitely someone that just ran with the punch.
Oh, yeah. But it was very entertaining.
Oh, yes.
Seriously, very entertaining.
It definitely was entertaining.
I could watch that stuff all day. We met him, I remember, in Plymouth. And
yes.
Another person, very, very humble.
Yes.
Very humble. But will bend over backwards to entertain you. Like, that's,
oh, yeah.
You know, that's the type of people that they're trying to stick with now in wrestling, too, because you don't want the drama. No. Everybody's tired of that portion of it. They dealt with it going into, you know, the years that they've had this company, and I can definitely tell it's definitely a good change for.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
The better.
I definitely agree with you with that. It's definitely a change for the better. Series 12, right here in the green package.
Big Boss Man.
Big Boss Man. You have the next Undertaker.
Yep.
This is more of like the Ministry of Darkness type of Undertaker.
Yes. Yeah.
Which was pretty cool. You have Mick Foley with Socko on his hand and Big Show, but he was actually posted and named Paul Wright on the back of the boxes.
Yes. Yeah.
So.
And I think Steve Austin had one in that, didn't he, in that series?
They did have Steve Austin, yes, at that series. He was a throw-in guy that they did throw in towards the end. Yes, he was.
What about Series 13? Has D'Lo Brown, there was actually quite a few people.
Yes.
Draws, Hardcore Holly,
yep.
Shane McMahon, and Steve Austin.
Yep.
So this was actually the last series in the regular Bendham style.
Yes.
Didn't they make them bigger or something?
Well, they made them with gear to them, and they started to change the packaging in the boxes. When this series came out, they didn't know how much longer they were actually going to do.
Right.
Austin was actually released for Series 12. It's not on the package. It was on the package for here, Series 13.
Yep.
If you get the Stone Cold Steve Austin figure, they have them in both color boxes, both different numbers, still listed the same in the back.
Nice.
And if anybody doesn't know anything about Draws, learn about him. He was a former football player, turned wrestler. He ended up getting paralyzed in the ring. And now he does a lot of media work and stuff for WWE on the website and stuff.
Nice.
They did come out with a couple other things. They came out with Series 14, which we don't have anything here of. Matt and Jeff, the Hardy Boys, The Rock, and also Chris Jericho.
Jericho, yeah.
Now, the thing with this series, when they came out with it, they also came out with this series. It was the Gear series.
Yep.
This series has The Rock, Stone Cold Steve Austin, Kane, Triple H. It also had the Hardy Boys in it.
Nice.
When these hit the shelves, people thought, okay, well, maybe that Jeff Hardy, Matt Hardy series, this is what they're doing. They switched it.
Right.
They actually didn't switch it.
Right.
It was just a replace quick into it. So if you can get the Hardy Boys, grab them. I actually just seen them online for $100 with two of them.
Right.
And then the rarest series of them all is Series 15, a whole new look, whole new box style. It has Scotty 2 Hardy. It has The Rock, Grandmaster Sexy, Rikishi, and Taz. Those are very, very hot items right now.
Oh, yeah.
Those are something that you do want to get. And I'm going to tell you guys first, I have been in on a little inside tip. WWE made the retro figures for the Hasbro figures. Mm-hmm. From what I'm understanding is the next throwback figures they're going to be making are the Bendhams again.
Nice.
They're supposed to be coming back.
Awesome.
They're starting already with prototypes. And they have a couple guys like Dink that was showing right now.
Great.
And also Adam Bomb. These are guys that they wanted to make in the series that they haven't made. I heard when they come out with these, they are going to do some back guys.
Nice.
And Adam Bomb and Dink may actually be released.
Nice.
Now, we did say something that WCW had some. Here's the Bret Hart from WCW.
Yep.
I just kind of had a show because, hey, I'm a huge Bret Hart fan.
Hey,
but they had a bunch of figures in their series, DDP, Kevin Nash, Booker T, Scott Hall, and the list goes on with that.
Right.
Now, each and every week, we tell you guys to send us in your questions. We want to know what you want us to answer, why you want us to answer them, and we're going to let you know from our personal opinions.
Here we go.
So we're going to try to get to as many questions as we want that we can get to. First one I see, should WWE have a women's tag team title? Yes.
Yes.
They had it before.
Yes.
Now they need it even more.
Definitely. Definitely, yes.
Right?
My question is, should Melina be in the WWE Hall of Fame? I definitely think that she should be.
I agree with you.
I agree.
I think she made a big role into getting WWE back on the map, bringing the female revolution to a stop. Me and Pebbles talked about that a few weeks back. So I think it's definitely something good.
Oh, yeah.
What was your thoughts on WCW's television title? This was a title belt that was always able to be defended on TV, mm-hmm. only for TV purpose. I personally like the idea of it, mm-hmm. and I wish WWE would come back with something like this. And that would give belts like the Intercontinental title, something, or the U.S. Open Challenges, something they don't always have to do.
Right.
They could just do to a TV title. They can have a B-lister hold it. I think it will help them out a lot.
Right.
So yeah, I liked it.
Should DMX make a permanent return?
So DMX?
I mean DX.
I don't think DMX should make a permanent return. He only had a couple songs.
Dude, I like DMX. Okay. He should make a permanent return.
I think DX shouldn't. I think as a special appearance on WrestleMania or something like that. Yeah.
Special appearances, but yes. But to make
the
them
spotlight,
permanent, no.
No.
Would take away from too much stuff.
Right.
Too much stuff.
Didn't at one time WCW give a 20 count for their count outs? They did. Yes. When they changed from WCCW to WCW and they were trying to start to compete with Ted Turner took it over, they wanted to be different from WWE. Mm-hmm. And what they did at that time was they changed the 10 count to 20 count.
Wow.
And also, if you threw the guy over the top rope, you got disqualified.
Wow.
They didn't change that until about 97, 98 mm-hmm. when they were really on TV for Nitro and they seen that it was starting to get over. That's where they gave away the over the top rule and also cut it down to 10 minutes, especially when they do the cruiserweights and stuff like that.
Right.
It was a lot better for them.
Right. Do you think Adam Rose and No Way Jose would make a good team? I definitely think that they would make a all right team. I don't know if it would be like a successful team.
I think they have a
But
a
I think
chance.
They'd be an all right
They're
All
kind
right
of like the
team.
Fashion Police. They're, for some reason, the Fashion Police is pulling it off fantastically.
Yeah.
But at first, you kind of didn't know. I think the gimmicks would be entertaining. I think they can play it probably for like a month to a month and a half.
Yeah, I think it would last
After
a little
that,
bit.
I think it would be kind of a stretch for them.
Yeah, I definitely think their gimmicks are good. Whether they're, you know, individually or even if you mashed them together as a tag team. I think that they're, you know, it would be like Matt and Jeff. It would be something that would, you know, fit well together. And they would fit well separately also. But I don't know how long it would run, if it would be a long enough reign like Matt and Jeff.
Yeah.
You know?
Should WWE bring back midget wrestlers?
Definitely. Definitely, there is a high calling for that.
Yes.
I know a lot of people that still talk about midget wrestling.
I like that the New England area is really mass producing the midget wrestling.
Oh, yeah.
I think independent leagues should use a lot more midgets to get WWE start thinking. And if they're going to bring back people like Hornswoggle, El Torito, make a division for midget wrestlers. Don't let them be just a side piece on the show.
Yeah.
Because they're very entertaining. They're a great break of a show if it's doing two serious, you know, storylines.
Right.
It'd be a great way to split up your double main events at a pay-per-view instead of sticking in a women's match that so many people want to see. Give the break in between with a midget match. Get the laughs, get the laughter out there. Make a full division. And there's plenty out there.
Right.
They really
right.
are.
And it's not, you know, just for the, you know, laughter about it. Like they're just they even though they're, you know, out there for midget wrestling, like midget wrestling because they're midgets, like whatever, it's not like they're still out there and they're still human beings and they're still wanting to entertain you. So
I think they
should have their own time to be able to, you know, wrestle each other so they're not, like you said, the side piece.
And
they're not a character.
I think,
you know, like
they
work
so much harder, though. You know what I mean? Because of their height, you know, challenges they have. To climb the turnbuckles, when I climb a turnbuckle, I can get up there. But when I'm, you know, 15 minutes in, it's a little tiring.
Yeah.
Think about for them, and they're up there. And
they have twice as long to go.
They
have twice as much to do.
They feel like they have to deliver more than they really need to deliver.
Yep.
And they put on great things. I think it would be great to have
Very
them
entertaining,
there.
Yep. This is a good question for me. What gimmick was better, Mr. Kennedy or Mr. Anderson? I am going to tell you, I love me some Mr. Anderson.
Yeah.
I definitely think he was so much better than Mr. Kennedy.
You know, just to clear the air, it's the same person we're talking about.
I know,
and
but
just to clear the air, it's exactly
does,
the same gimmick.
But as Mr.
But
Anderson, though, he
I
just
say
has
Mr.
that little flair.
Yeah, I would say he was able to play the gimmick out just a little bit more for Anderson, so I'm going to go with Anderson.
Yeah.
Hands down.
He was good as Mr. Kennedy. Even though it's the same person, same gimmick, you did a name change, whatever, but like in all honesty, when he did do the name change, it really did make a difference.
That's true. We're going to try to get to one more question here today. Okay. Off the ropes this past week, you guys talk about the Hardy Boys. Who is the best Hardy in your opinion?
Jeff, all the way, hands down.
You were just talking about Matt before the show.
Okay, all right. And I will tell you, the first time I ever met Jeff.
And what about Jason and Jake and Ben and Scott?
Really?
Really. There's really not that many. You're going with Jeff?
I am definitely going with Jeff.
Yeah. You know, as much as I like Matt with the creativity, with the deletion, with everything like that, just a little bit more I'm for Jeff. Just because he gives that much more. And that dude has a million one different ways he signs his name. You know what I mean? So it's really out there.
And it's the same signature every time.
Yeah, it's just
too.
A little extra thing.
It's just
extra
a little squiggle, but you know.
Make sure you guys check us next week as well, too, for our next episode for Figures R Us.
Yeah.
It's going to be featuring the classic superstar series of the WWE. We want to make sure everybody has a safe and happy 4th of July.
Yes,
we're
definitely.
Going to be, if you guys are out partying, having some fun, eating all those hot dogs and get a little tired, we are going to run this for 2 weeks, same for Off the Ropes, so everybody can have a nice holiday season, well, week and stuff. So be safe for the 4th of July.
Definitely
don't
be
go
safe,
slamming
guys.
Any Yokozunas out there. Lex
don't
already did it
crazy.
Before. It was great.
If you're going to drink, please be responsible. If you're going to use fireworks, please be responsible.
Yeah, be smart about that,
we
guys.
We want you to enjoy your holidays. We want you to enjoy, just like they do with wrestling, the entertainment portion of it. But please do be responsible.
You can tell she works in the office. So anyway, folks, we want to thank you so much for tuning in this week to Figures R Us. Keep sending those questions into us at wrestling_museum. Just drop the G on Twitter or to the official wrestlingmuseum.com. We'll try to get to your questions the next show that we have. Next show, like I said, is Classic Superstars. Next, Off the Ropes, is about the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Happy 4th of July. And I'm
going to
go
fourth,
check
guys.
Out the official wrestlingmuseum.com.
Bye.